So we are going to look at robot programming and languages. So when you talk about robot programming, you'll find that the robot manipulators usually differentiate themselves from the fixed automation by being flexible. And when you say that they are always flexible, what we mean is that they are programmable. We can easily program them in order to change the sequence by which they are able to carry out a work cycle. So you'll find that in most cases, they not only are the movements of the manipulators are the ones that are programmable, but you'll find that also they usually use the sensors. They use the sensors and the communication with other factory automation. And you can find that the manipulators can also adopt various ways as we proceed with the task or as the task proceed. So we can talk about a robot program first. So let's talk about a robot program. A robot program. So when you talk about a robot program, then basically a robot program can be defined as generally a path that is followed or a path that is to be followed by the manipulator. And this one is always combined with the peripheral actions that support the work cycle. So that path that is going to be followed by the manipulator in order to achieve the work cycle involving the peripheral actions is what we refer to as a robot program. And when you talk about the peripheral actions, the peripheral actions usually include what we can talk about as the opening and closing of the gripper, where that the gripper is now the end effector. You can also talk about the performing or the performance of logical decision making. And also, you can talk about communicating with other processes of equipment in the robot cell. So when you talk about in the robot environment, there will be several equipment and also several pieces of equipment that will be found in that particular robot cell. And therefore, there is a need for this communication to take place. Then we can again talk about robot languages. Robot languages. When you talk about the robot languages, these ones are languages that have been developed for the ease of controlling the motions of the robot. And we know that the robots usually have different structures and also there are different geometrical capabilities. So when you talk about the programming languages, you'll find that each and every robot has a language as defined by the designer. The designer of the robot usually determines the language that the robot can use. And there are several languages in this case that are always used. Just by a way of example, we usually have a language like Wave. We have a language like AL, VAL, AL, VAL, among others. So there are several. There is HELP, there is MCL, there is PAL, and so on and so forth. So these ones are some of the languages, the robot languages, and these ones are always defined by the maker, or rather the designer of that particular robot. So you're supposed to define these languages, and these languages usually provide flexibility to the user, and the flexibility is always very, very important in defining the task that is supposed to be performed. They are supposed to define the task that is supposed to be performed, and they are supposed to also, they do also permit the motion of the task to be defined, but and also provide the user with the ability to inspire intelligence in the control program. So when it is carrying out the simple tasks, in performing simple tasks, the intelligence may check the binary sensors and change the location or make simple decisions that are based on sensory information in order to handle exceptions. So in that case, we are simply talking about, when we talk about the robot languages, we are talking about developing some sort of algorithm It is the capability of developing some sort of algorithm that is going to control the robot in its specific application in order to carry out a work cycle. So in this case, you'll find that there is also use of the high-level languages, which usually provide more general approach, also in solving a human-robot communication. So basically, that is the introduction as far as the robot programming and languages are concerned. So I want us to go to the specific to be specific to the robot programming. So let's talk about robot programming. So when you talk about the robot programming, then what we have to understand is that the robots are always used in order to perform assembly tasks. The robots that are used in order to form to carry out assembly tasks usually require high-level programming techniques. This is because you'll find that the robot assembly usually relies on a sensory feedback. They rely on a sensory feedback, and this type of unstructured interaction can only be handled by conditionally programmed methods. So that is the need for the robot programming. And you'll find that, again, the robot programming is always different from traditional programming in several sense, in that you'll find that there are other considerations that have to be taken in place when carrying out robot programming. Like one of them, one consideration that you must take in place is that the objects that are supposed to be manipulated by the robot are always three-dimensional objects, which have a variety of physical properties. You'll find that in most cases, in other programming, we don't usually have three dimension. And therefore, that one makes the robot programming unique. And that is one of the considerations which must be handled by any robot programming. Because here we talk about movement of physical equipment, or movement, when you talk about the movement of the end effectors as well as the manipulator, we can talk about the movement of the manipulator. So the movement of the manipulator will be the manipulator itself is in three dimensions. So if you have to consider the aspect of the three dimension. Another thing that is also very, very important to put into consideration is that robots usually operate in specially a complex environment. So they operate in specially complex environment. And when you talk about specially complex environment, then what comes into the mind is what we talked about in the robot qualities as the spatial intrusion. So this one, you'll find that there are several arms of the robot that are supposed to be moving. So in that case, there is a lot of movement, and that is now what we are talking about, a specially complex environment. The other consideration that has to be taken into consideration is actually the description and the representation of three-dimensional objects in the computer, which are usually imprecise. So when you talk about the representation of three-dimensional objects in the computer, you'll find that they are always imprecise, and therefore that one also has to be taken into consideration. The fourth consideration is that the sensory information has to be monitored. The sensory information has to be monitored. It has to be manipulated, and also it must be properly utilized so that you have to ensure that every information as far as sensing is concerned is monitored. And this is because the robot, in the robot environment or in the work envelope, we can have several equipment, and the sensory information has to be monitored in order to avoid the collision with other equipment. So what are the approaches that are done? What are the approaches to programming? So we can talk about approaches to programming. Approaches to robot programming. Approaches to robot programming. Approaches to robot programming. Generally, here we usually have two approaches that we're going to talk about. One of them is always what we refer to as the robot-oriented programming. Robot-oriented programming. The robot-oriented programming. And the other one, we can talk about the object-oriented or we can talk about the object-oriented or task-level programming. Robot-oriented or task-level programming. Robot-oriented or task-level programming. So these ones are the two approaches that are always used in order to program the robot. So we are going to look at the first approach that is used in robot programming. And the first approach is, as we have stated, it is the robot-oriented programming. So when you talk about the robot-oriented programming, in this type of programming, we usually have an assembly of tasks. We usually describe an assembly of tasks as a sequence of robot motions. So in this case, we are looking at the robot and we are considering that an assembly of tasks is taken to be or is explicitly described as a sequence of robot motions. That is to say that the robot is guided and controlled. What we do is that the robot is guided and controlled by the program through the entire task, which in this case, the robot is what we look at. Every program is looking at the robot. So in this case, what we are simply saying is that the robot will be guided and controlled by the program through the entire task. And with each statement that is given, in the algorithm that we give, in the algorithm of robot-oriented programming, each of the statement of the program is roughly corresponding to one action of the robot. So that is what we refer to as the robot-oriented programming. The second one that we are talking about is the object-oriented programming. The object-oriented programming. So when you talk about the object-oriented programming, then we are simply talking about, we describe assembly of tasks as a sequence of positional goals. So in this case, we look at the assembly of tasks. What we are looking at is the object that is supposed to be carried out. This one should be object-oriented, not the object-oriented. So in this case, we are simply talking about that particular object that is supposed to be moved. It forms the basis of programming. That is now when we talk about the object oriented. So in this case, we say that the program describes the assembly of tasks as a sequence of positional goals of the object rather than the motion of the robot, as we saw in the robot oriented. We look at the positional goals of the object, not the motion of the robot, in order to achieve the goals. And in this case, there is no explicit robot motion that is specified. And then now we can look at again the considerations that we have to look at in the various or the considerations that are always important in robot programming. When one of the considerations is that we usually talk of the three-dimensional objects with three different physical properties that are supposed to be manipulated. We can also talk about the environment of the robot operations, which can be complex. Another one is the visualization of the object. They can be discrete in nature. And then the other one we can talk about is that the processing and the analysis of the digital data from the sensors and the visions systems has to be done in real time. So that is those ones are the two approaches that are always used as far as the robot, as far as the approaches to robot programming are concerned. So let's look at the methods of programming robots work cycle. Methods of programming robots work cycle. The methods of programming robots work cycle. Methods of programming robots work cycle. Methods of programming robots work cycle. So we want to look at the methods of programming the robot's work cycle. So you'll find that there are always various methods which can be used to program or to perform a given work cycle. And this one can be divided into the following categories. We can have this category. We can talk about each one. So the first one is what we call, let's name them first. We have the manual method. We have the manual method. So the first one, we have the manual method. The second one, we have what we refer to as the walkthrough method. Walkthrough method. We have what we refer to as the walkthrough method. Then we have what we refer to as the lead through or the online method. We have lead through, or we can refer to it as online method. Lead through or online method. Then we have offline also. We can refer to it as offline programming method. Offline programming method. So these ones are some of the categories under which we can use the robots in order to achieve a work cycle. So the first one that we are going to talk about is what we refer to as the manual programming method. The manual programming method. We can talk of the first one, which is the manual method, or we can refer to it as the manual programming method. So when you talk about the manual programming method, then basically we are simply talking about it is more of like a machine setup. It is more of like a machine setup, and it is always described, best described as machine setup rather than programming. And in this case, it is always used in less sophisticated robots, like you can talk of the limit sequence, you can talk of the pick and place robots, and it just involves setting of mechanical stops, cams, that is the computer-aided manufacturing, the switches and the relays in the robot control. So even though these may be regarded as simple, they are always capable of performing many tasks in the manufacturing, and they can be used in applications that usually require less sophisticated operations or robots, and there is no need in order to invest in more complex robots. So basically what we are talking about as far as the manual method or manual programming method is concerned, we are simply talking about that method whereby we simply set. It is just called the machine set, whereby we have the mechanical stops, the cams, the switches and the relays are what we usually set in order to achieve a given work cycle. The second one that we can talk about now is the walkthrough programming method. So is the walkthrough programming method. We can talk of the walkthrough programming method. Walkthrough programming method. Walkthrough programming method. So when you talk about the walkthrough programming method, then here we are simply talking about an experienced programmer or an operator who will manually move the robot's hands. He moves the robot's hands and arm through the desired motions or the sequence of the work cycle. So he will move the robot's arm or hands through the required motions that, or the desired motions, or we can also or the desired motions that are needed in order to achieve a sequence of work cycle. And each of these movements will be recorded into the memory for sequence playback during production. So it is like the operator who already has a mastery of how the work cycle or the procedure of the work cycle move the robot arms and also or the hand in that particular order in order to achieve the work cycle. And at the end of it, these movements that are achieved by the operator and by the robot with the help of the operator will be recorded into the memory, and these ones will be subsequently played back now during production. The speed by which these movements are performed, the speeds by which we perform this movement are usually controlled independently so that the programmer does not have to worry about the cycle during the walkthrough. So that is how this one is supposed to work. So, but actually the main concern is always getting the position sequence correct, and it is always appropriate for, this one can be appropriate for activities like, we can talk of spray painting, we can talk about welding and so on. So in walkthrough, here in this case, we are simply, the main thing is that operator or that programmer, the experienced programmer, ensuring that he masters the moves that are supposed to be carried out in a certain work cycle. Then he takes the robot through by moving the arms and or the hands of the robot in order to achieve that work cycle. All this will be taken to the memory of that particular robot, and then after that they will be played back during production. So the main thing here is, and that is why we were stressing on the experienced programmer, is that ability to master or getting the position sequence correct. And we've said that this one can be used in areas like, we can talk of spray painting, we can talk about welding, among other applications. So that is for the second one, that is walkthrough programming. The third one, we can talk of the lead through or online method, or we can talk of it as teach pendant. We can talk of lead through online, or at times we refer to it as teach pendant. Online method, or we can talk of it as, again, a lead through or teach pendant method. So when you talk about the teach pendant method, this one is almost the same as what we have talked about before, but now in this case the robot has to be placed in a mode whereby it will not be in a position to carry out the task. So we put it in a mode that will not be carrying the task, but as it is taught, it is going to make those particular movements. So in this method, we usually have the robot switched on to the program mode. We have it to be switched on into the program mode first. And when the operator, after being switched on to the program mode, the operator holds the robot arm and the manipulator or the moving part. You can talk of the arm, manipulator, or the wrist, and put it to the desired path. So we are simply saying that the robot is switched to the program mode. When the operator hold, then the operator will hold the robot's manipulator or its wrist to the desired path. And in this case, it usually makes use of what we refer to as the teach pendant. The teach pendant is just some component that has got several dials, whereby you can always have to control the movement. So you will have the teach pendant in order to power drive the robot through the motion sequence. The teach pendant, as we've said, is a small handheld device with switches and dials to control the robot's physical movement. It is just like something, it's very small, looks like a calculator, whereby as you dial, then the robot makes movement as per directed from the teach pendant. Each motion, again, will be recorded to the memory for future playback. The lead through is always very, very popular among the robot programming method because of the ease and the convenience. And again, the robot controller is always expected to memorize all the data that is generated. And also, during the playback, the robot describes the same path used during learning. And moreover, the editing facility can be provided in order to compensate for the error. So in this case, the robot does not carry out the tasks that is supposed to carry out, but rather it is put in the program mode first. After being put in the program mode, it is taught on what it is supposed to do in the real production. Then later on, it will be allowed to do that. So in that case, that is what we call the online. So you'll find that when the online is, it means that the robot is not idle, but again, it is not involved in production. So that is as far as the online method is. The last method that we are going to talk about is offline programming method. Offline programming method. So when you talk about the offline programming method, then this method usually involves the preparation of the robot's program offline. So you just go and write the program you write the algorithm that is supposed to be followed by the robot. Then after that, you will bring the robot, and then the robot will be able to carry out that task. Of course, these ones will be in the memory. So you'll find that this method usually involves the preparation of the robot's program, and this one has to be done offline. That means that the robot is not involved. By the time you are writing the program, the robot itself may be doing a certain task. So the offline programming is typically accomplished on the computer terminal. So you write it on the computer. After the program has been prepared, then it is entered into the robot memory. You enter that particular program, you prepare the program, enter it into the robot memory, and then use it during the work cycle. The main advantage of offline programming is that the production time is not always lost to delay in teaching the robot a new task. So you ensure that in the case of the online programming, the robot was placed in program mode, which means the robot was unable to carry out the task. But when you talk of the offline, the program is written, and then it is kept on the computer, and then the robot will simply be brought in order to implement that particular work cycle. So in that case, you'll find that the production with the offline programming is that there will be no loss to delay in teaching the robot a new task. So you'll find that the programming offline can be done while the robot is still in production, while the robot is still in production and proceeding on the job. And that one means that there is higher utilization of the robot and the equipment which it operates. Again, in addition, you can also talk about the offline programming, that they usually have the prospect of integrating robot into the factory, CAD, CAM database, and information system, because every data will be already in the computer terminal. So those ones are what we talk about as far as the approaches that we have, as far as what we talked about as the methods that can be used to program the robot work cycle are concerned. So those ones are the methods that are always used. Another used method that is always, we did not talk about it here, but now that is now the software programming. And the software programming now takes us to the next phase that of this, and that is what we refer to as the programming languages. So we can talk about the programming languages. So when you talk about the software programming, at times this include the programming of the robots by means of a computer or high-level languages. And the high-level languages that we can talk about is the AML. AML was done by IBM Corporation. We also have HELP, H-E-L-P, that was done by the General Electric, as well as the AL that was done by Stanford University. We also have the RAIL that was done by Automatics, and there are several other programming methods, like we can talk about voice programming, which is also achieved by the operator reading and repeating phrases of words several times, and then the robot responds to the voice algorithm. Yes. So under software programming, we can look at the robot programming languages that are used. And remember, we say that mostly when you talk about the robot programming languages, then these programming languages are always designed by the manufacturer or the designer. So the person who designs the robot. So when you talk about the non-computer control robots, they do not usually require programming language. And in that case, we can use the approaches that we've talked about. That is the walkthrough, the lead through. While the simpler ones are a little bit complicated robots, we can use the walkthrough, the lead through. While when you talk of the simpler robots, we can usually use the manual. But with the introduction of the computer control for the robots, then came the opportunity and the need that the need to develop the computer-oriented programming languages. And we can talk about some of the programming languages. So when you talk about some of the programming languages, we can talk of the first one, the programming languages that we can talk about. We talk of the AL, or we usually refer to as the ARM language, that was developed by Stanford University, called ARM language, developed by Stanford University. The second one, we can talk of AML. That one was developed by IBM Corporation. We can talk of AML. That one was developed by IBM Corporation. The third one, we can talk of RAIL. R-A-I-L. The RAIL, that is from the automatics. We can also talk about RPL as a language. We can talk about VAL, that is the Vectors Assembly Language. VAL, Vectors Assembly Language. There is also HELP. We can also talk about HELP. We can also talk about the machine. We can talk about HELP. We can talk about Machine Control Language, MCL. Machine Control Language, MCL. And that one was developed by Douglas. We can talk of JAS, developed by NASA. Developed by NASA. This one was developed by Douglas. Talk of that. Then we can talk about RIPL, that is the Robot Independent Programming Language. I can talk about the Robot Independent Programming Language, RIPL. Another one that is also very, very common that we can talk about is the ladder logic. That is for the PLCs, controlled robots. Can talk of the ladder logic. And the other one that we can talk about is the wave. Wave. So those are some of the programming languages that we can talk about as far as the robots are concerned. But remember, this programming language, that is why you'll find that some of them we've talked about the person or where it was used. So it means that whenever you develop a robot, you can always come up with your own language that is going to be used in order to control that particular robot. So that is all as far as the robot programming and languages are concerned.